So on July 17th, we received a 911 call reporting that a person was struggling with, let me back up, sorry. I was thinking of that. What is it, salt? On July 17th, we received a 911 call to a residence on Salt Marsh Loop reporting that a person there was possibly deceased or in distress and had a large zip tie located around their neck. The fire department did arrive on scene, removed the zip tie, attempted to render aid. However, that person, Joycey Cartagena, was pronounced deceased on scene. Initially, the information that we were given by witnesses, people close to the victim, were indicating the possibility of suicide being what led to that incident. However, as a standard in any type of unattended death investigation, we treat it as a crime scene, process everything in the same way we would if it was an initial homicide response. And in doing so, and the information and interviews that we obtained in the days after the incident, it is clear at this point that suicide was not the cause of death, and it is being ruled as a homicide and treated as a homicide. It is a very active investigation. The investigators have been working for this for days on this, interviewing people, processing that evidence, and we do have a person of interest at this time. But we are not at the point in the investigation where we can give any details about that person or their relationship or connection to the case.
Should people be worried about this person of interest?
No, it appears to be an isolated incident, and this is the person of interest is somebody that is tied to the victim.
Who are the 911 calls from?
We don't disclose the 911 caller information.
Do we know, I know the Lake County Medical Examiner isn't giving out the autopsy yet as to the cause of death. Do you know was there a struggle? Did she show signs of struggle? Have you seen the autopsy? Is there anything you can tell us about that?
We don't have the complete autopsy report back, which is pretty standard it takes a few weeks, especially with toxicology and those kind of reports. We did get a confirmation today officially that they were ruling it as a homicide. As far as details about any kind of signs of struggle or injuries to the victim, we can't go into detail about that this time.
So you hear zip tie around the neck, you immediately think, you know, asphyxia, strangulation.
Right. And which is, you know, what the investigators were looking at on scene that day. The difference is whether or not that occurred at the victim's own doing, or whether, you know, that was something, you know, nefarious happened and it was done to the victim. And based on the investigation, the physical evidence, we're ruling out suicide.
And is strangulation the strongest supposition at this point, or do you sort of have any preliminary result?
At this point, that's where the investigative work's looking like. But again, we can't make any determination on that until the medical examiner gives us the full autopsy with toxicology and everything back.
The person of interest, can you share any information about the relationship? Give us a sense of how they relate.
I can't right now. The investigators, like I said, it's very active. There's always things happening behind the scenes in an investigation like this, and I can't give any information out about the person of interest.
Well, one would think that the 911 call had come from somebody who had either gone to visit her or gone to check on her and found her in this state. Mm-hmm. Were they worried about her, or was this like just somebody who dropped in?
I can tell you that we actually received two 911 calls regarding the incident. One was from her employer, who was sending out what's called a well-being check. There were some indicators that something was awry. She wasn't responding in like an online queue, like they're normally used to seeing. And on top of that, another person that we're not disclosing where that 911 call, you know, came from and who that person was.
So people worried about it because she didn't show up for work and she couldn't be reached.
Well, it wasn't that, not that she didn't show up for work. It appears that she was a remote worker. So they often sign on and have to be active in an online queue. That wasn't happening, and that is why the well-being check took place.
On the CAD report, it made it sound like maybe it was a child that had called 911.
It was not.
It was not a child.
Anything else?
So this happened on July 17th. So, you know, why did Sanford Police put this out sooner?
Again, the initial indications that we were receiving information from people close to the victim that there was a possibility that it was suicide. It's pretty standard protocol with us. If it is a suicide, we don't generally release that information. This, like I said, we hadn't confirmed that it was that, but we were still treating it as an unattended, possibly suspicious death. So in the days after that, when we started getting more information indicating that it was going to move towards a homicide, that's kind of where we've geared up and where we are today. We literally just this afternoon got the official green light from the ME to call it a homicide.
I'm sorry, I'm a few years late, so I'm going to ask questions that's already asked. The part that on 911 call that mentioned cut her down, what was that referring to?
The 911 call is really hard to really make detailed or at this point was say what exactly was said. The caller is definitely emotional and not really making complete sentences. We do hear cut it off. We're at this point it appears that they're referring to the zip tie around the neck.
Do you know if there's any history of calls to this residence prior to this at all?
I don't have that information offhand, but there isn't anything that indicates that the victim had any kind of, she was known to us in any way. By all accounts, she, you know, was an upstanding citizen, good job, is respected, family that loves her.
She lived there with her son, only.
I don't know who resided in the house with her.
Who made that call?
We can't disclose who the 911 caller was.
Why not?
Well, one, they're protected, and two, it's part of the investigation. So, kind of two exemptions on that.
So we request the calls. Are we not going to receive them?
You can, you'll receive the 911 calls, but as a standard, the caller information will be redacted.
No, I know that, but we're going to get calls.
Absolutely. I think she's already sent them out.
Okay.
Yeah. And the one is, like I said, the caller is very emotional, and it's hard to listen and also hard to really understand what that caller was saying. Any other questions?
Is that caller a family member?
We're not disclosing any information about that.
And I'm sorry, again, I'm 2 minutes late.
Well, we had said the person of interest, we do have a person of interest. We are not at the stage in the investigation where we are ready to disclose any information about the person of interest, the relationship that between the victim and the person of interest, or anything of that substance.
And I know the officer on the report had a body cam. Are we able to get the body cam at all?
That's going to be part of their evidence in their investigation, so that's not ready to be released right now.
Should neighbors or residents be concerned?
No, it appears that it's an isolated incident and that the, as of this point, it appears that the victim and the person of interest were known to each other. Any other questions? Covered it? All right. I don't have any indication as to when we'll have an update on the case. Like I said, there's wheels turning, there is active things happening with the case, and so who knows, it could be tomorrow, it could be in a week from now, I'm not sure.
Is your person of interest cooperating in the investigation?
I'm not at liberty to say that yet. All right.
What would you like to talk about the fellow who was arrested in Lewis County for?
With the dirt bike? Yes. So, what was the date? Do you know the
February 24th.
February 24th.
Thank you. I wasn't ready for that one. But February 24th, we had a horrific fatality, two fatalities actually, that occurred right up the road on 13th Street. A male had two young juveniles on his dirt bike and was speeding down the road, ignoring any kind of traffic signal device and any regard for safety. At this point, there was a prolonged period between us arriving here, and that was because he was in critical life-threatening condition for a very prolonged period of time in the hospital. He has since been released, and we issued a warrant for his arrest regarding the death of the two young children. And this morning, Volusia County picked him up on that warrant, and he's in custody in Volusia County.
His name is?
Randy Cambridge.
Randy Cambridge.
Okay, so the Randy Cambridge that we see in the jail website, June 1st of 88. That's your guy.
Yeah, Randy Cambridge is the person that we issued an arrest warrant for in relation to the death of the two young children that died as a result of his recklessness and carelessness in the vehicle crash involving the dirt bike they were on.
Those were his kids, right? No helmets?
As far as I know, they are his children, and there were no helmets. There was no safety device of any kind happening. There was nothing in regard to safety happening in that moment in time.
It was 7:30 at night in February, so it was dark.
It was already dark, and again, speed was a major factor in that. And then on top of that, the lack of safety for two young, one was a toddler on that dirt bike.
So. 2 and 5, right?
Yes.
And do we know what was like the 2-year-old in front of the father and the 5-year-old on the back? Or do we have
I don't have the exact positioning of where they were on the bike. I don't know if that was in the press release. Where they were on the bike, at the front or the back, I don't recall.
But it's 2 counts of aggravated manslaughter of a child.
Yeah, and I believe a fleeing and eluding charge on top of that. But the main ones are the regarding the death of the children.
And that's why there's no charges in the court yet, because he was in the hospital.
Yeah, I mean, he was in there for a pretty long period of time, and we didn't know what the prognosis or the outcome was going to be. And then at this point, he was released, and so now, you know, he's going to face the consequences of that decision.
What was the fleeing and eluding? Was he running from you guys when he crashed?
He must have taken off, I think, right after. I'd have to look into that. It's been a while, and I don't have that report in front of me. I'm sorry.
I don't know if there's going to be fleeing and eluding or not. He was busted up pretty bad. I think he was probably still in the street.
Maybe. I'm not sure if they initially, I don't know, I'd have to look. I don't know if there was a traffic stop before that. I'd have to look. I'm not sure. I don't recall the details.
Okay.
Yep.
Thank you for spending some time with us. Always
no problem. Thank you. And I know some of you guys, it's kind of been a weird transition, but Officer Townsend, Tammy, she is the daily, day-to-day PIO. If you need those reports, like CC me, of course, because some of the times we're on vacation. But if you need it in a pinch in the daytime, that's your go-to. And then